the praise and the glory for that. Do you love the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Glory to God. I love the Lord. And I'm just so thankful that He's brought us rain today and we so desperately needed it.
Yeah.
Oh, it's it, but you got to laugh. And in August, we'll all be begging for this rain probably. So we'll just take it. And Lord's in control. And thank God He is in control and we're not. But did you come to worship the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, we come before you humbly. Lord, we ask for you to fill our cup this morning. And the only way that cup can be filled is by you. We ask for the Spirit to move, oh God, this morning. Lord, that whatever takes place today will bring glory and honor to you for those that are here in the sanctuary and those that are at home, wherever in the world they may be. Father, we're here to magnify you. We ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus, and all of God's children said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and worship the Lord. How many believe Jesus is in this house?
Amen.
Come on, we know he is.
Well, there's a man in here who turns water to wine, and he walks on the water and gives sight to the blind. Thank you.
want to. If you don't, that's fine with us. Thank you, Lord.
Well, I thought number one would surely be me. All I could be, all I wanted to be, all I could be.
And the Holy Spirit just filled me. I was about to bust out just praising the Lord in tongues on the way here. Do you need your cup filled today?
Yes.
Those of you at home, do you need your cup filled? Yes. I think we all do, sister. Brothers, we need our cup filled.
Amen.
I want to make sure that you understand the lyrics of this song. Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy. And then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from my well that shall never run dry. There are millions in this world who are seeking for pleasures earthly goods afford. But none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord. Are you listening at home? Are you listening at home? There are millions in this world who are seeking for pleasures earthly goods afford. But none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord. So my brother, if the things that this world gives you leave hungers that won't pass away, my blessed Lord will come and save you. If you kneel to Him and humbly pray, fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsty under my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. Come on, team. Let's praise Him, church. This morning.
My cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord.
I'm not afraid to
practice that in the car. The Holy Ghost began to move on me, Sister Mary, because I had forgotten the words of that song. But when she began to softly just recite the lyrics too, the Holy Spirit just began to move on me. When she said, there are millions in this world who are seeking for pleasures earthly goods afford, but none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ, my Lord. Do you love the Lord this morning?
Yes.
There are millions out there that are lost. The church is still here, thank God. And we're still going to continue to proclaim the blood of Jesus is still enough. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to the Gospel according to John. Gospel according to John, chapter 11. We'll begin at the 35th verse. John chapter 11, verse 35. We will read all the way down through to the 44th verse. John chapter 11, beginning at the 35th verse. In full disclosure, before we begin reading, this message is going to come with a warning label. Some of you went to wrong movies at times, and there's a warning on there. Or you might be watching a show where it pops on and says, parental guidance suggested, that this content may not be suitable. It may offend. Well, let me tell you, this morning at 5:30, when the Lord began to deal with my heart, I know again, Brother Fletcher, what the Bible means according to the writer of Hebrews. It says the word is quick, meaning it's alive. And it is sharper than any two-edged sword. Because brothers and sisters, I bled a little bit this morning as the Holy Spirit began to do a little surgery on your pastor. So buckle up, church. Here we go. John chapter 11, the 35th verse, the shortest verse in all the canon of Scripture, two words, Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus, therefore, again, groaning in himself, comes to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time he stinks, for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said unto her, said I not unto you that if you would believe, you should see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I knew that you hear me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that you have sent me. And when he had thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto them, loose him and let him go. Loose him and let him go. And I want to use for a subject this morning. What? This is a question now. What is the condition of your clothes? Question mark. What is the condition of your clothes? Question mark. Let us pray. Father, Lord, we surrender this vessel completely unto thy service, thy word, thy spirit. Lord, we must have the anointing of the Spirit to deliver what we believe and you desire to give unto the people this morning. Lord, get me out of the way. completely. Please take over all of our hearts and our minds this morning, no matter how uncomfortable it may be, that you desire to show us some things this morning and draw us closer unto thee. And we thank you for that, Father, for your love. In Jesus' name, and everyone said amen and amen. Again, full disclosure, this is not a typical message per se. It is not milk. You're not going to get fed milk this morning. You're going to get the total. As a matter of fact, you're not even going to get vegetables this morning. You're going to get the meat and maybe a little raw meat at that. I have been blessed to be a minister of the gospel for approximately 11 years. God called me a few years before that, and even before that, and I resisted. I ignored the call, pushed him aside, because like so many songs that we sing, it was all about me, Brother Fletcher. It was about what I wanted to do. Brother Fletcher has told me this, I don't know how many times, and told his congregation, people are going to do what they want to do. Pastor, you can't change them. People are going to do what they want to do. But what if what you want to do is not what he wants you to do? It's awful quiet here. What if what you desire is not what God desires for you? In those 11 years or so, I preached in the prison ministry, and I ministered in multiple different churches in multiple states. And by the grace of God, when the advertisements that we would make, when we would invite evangelists to our church over the years, they would always say, contact the pastor so-and-so, and they would give out the number. Therefore, over the years, I've had people that called me just with questions, with prayer requests, and many of those dear brothers and sisters from then until now still call me. Matter of fact, I had one at 7:30 this morning from South Texas. Oh, she has some questions. But praise the Lord. I said, Holy Ghost, help me. Holy Ghost, help me. But I want the Spirit now to really dig a little bit and probe us all. Again, I was cut a little bit this morning in full disclosure. Out of all the prayer requests in the last few years that I get, there are, brother, pastor, I'm sick. I'm going to the doctor. I'm having test runs. My wife's sick. My husband's sick. My children are sick. We're having financial problems, Pastor. My family member has lost their job. My son or daughter is not behaving correctly. Or my spouse is not behaving correctly. Don't shake your head, yes. I told you it cut me. She's going to cut me again. And all those are right. We are to pray for one another. We are to take those petitions and those requests to the Lord regarding whatever your needs are. We take them to the Heavenly Father in Jesus' name, and we bind our faith together in one accord and take them to the throne room of God. Amen? But I've noticed something. In the last year or so, most of the requests of prayer, or at least pretty close to, is my family. Meaning your family. Your family. I'm not talking about just in this church. I'm talking about the people that contact me from multiple states. I can think of 5 states where I've been contacted in the last year, where I've counseled husband and wife and others, mother regarding her children, about Satan is coming against my family, coming against my home. That I am experiencing spiritual warfare. I don't know what to do, Pastor.
And again, this is right and just. We take our prayers and petitions to the Lord, no matter what the request is. Nothing's too hard for God, amen?
Amen.
Nothing's too hard for our Lord. So we take everything to the Lord in prayer. But in the last days, in church, you better listen to me this morning. We are living in the last days, and I'm going to prove it to you from the Word of Almighty God. We have quoted this scripture many times, but I'm going to do it again. This is Paul's last letter, 2 Timothy. His last letter before he would leave this world, 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning at the very first verse, he would say, and leave it for Timothy, the evangelist, he leaves it to us. This know also, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those who are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away. In other words, if you can encapsulate what Paul wrote there for Timothy and you and I, the Word of God tells us there is no self-restraint. And he's not writing this to unbelievers. Hello, this Bible, the Word of God, is for believers.
Amen.
There are many unbelievers that look at it and go, this is fiction. This is fables. But the Word of God is for believers. And Paul is telling us that the latter day church looks just like this. The two churches, the Laodicean and the Philadelphia church, in the lateness of the hour of the church age, running concurrently, meaning simultaneously at the same time, you've got the blood-bought church, and then you've got the apostatized church, the church that is apostatized. They're full of apostasy, meaning they have turned from truth, they have left their first love, and they are rich, increased with goods, and they say they have need of nothing. And when we do that, that's the result, church. But it won't happen overnight. It is a slow process over time that a little bit of leaven begins to creep in behind the pulpit, behind the songs, then it gets in your heart. It will get into your heart slowly. It's like a cancer that just starts and metastasizes and then begins to grow. Sometimes there's a fast-growing cancer, and sometimes there's a slow-growing cancer. It depends upon where and who you yield to. What are you yielding yourself to on a daily basis? And the Word of God is telling me right there that perilous times shall come in the last days. That right there that we just read together, or I read to you, you know that's true. Come on. Yeah. What I just read to you, every one of you ought to say amen. Because it's true, church. The Word of God cannot lie. That is what is facing the church today. And what happens is they have a form of godliness.
Yes.
Religion. They have their formalities. They do things a certain way. Walk a certain way. Last week, glory to God, the Holy Spirit moved in this house and we had a Jericho march, amen? Yeah. The Holy Spirit's in charge of this house because we glorify, edify, magnify, and praise Jesus Christ our Lord, and then the Holy Spirit's in the house because he guides in all truth. I want the Spirit of the living God in charge of this church, amen?
Amen.
But if he's not, it's because we moved our faith from Jesus Christ, his atoning work at Calvary, the blood of Jesus. And then I'm going to say it again. It's just a creeping effect. You won't notice it overnight. But all of a sudden, you're going to have a crack. You're going to be tested. And all of a sudden, uh-oh. You're going to have an uh-oh moment. And then one uh-oh moment, if you're not careful, can become a lifestyle of uh-ohs. And then, as time goes on, we talked about this Wednesday night, the heart can get so hard, then we no longer believe. Jesus is telling Martha, do you believe? It's not what you do or what you don't do. It's what you believe, church. If you believe right, you will act right because the Holy Spirit will be in control.
Amen.
I didn't say sinless perfection. I just told you this morning that the Holy Spirit cut me. He actually gutted me like a pig for a second. I was crying and weeping, and Lord, I see what you're saying. That I allowed the Holy Spirit to examine me. And I don't want you to think about your sons, your daughters, your parents, your spouse, your soon-to-be spouse, the problems of the day. Get that out of your mind right now. Look at the man in the mirror. Amen. Amen. Allow the Holy Spirit to examine you from this time forward until the end of this service. Brother Fletcher led us in a song last week. I believe it was last week. The old man is dead. Wasn't it last week? The old man is dead. I want to ask you, is your old man dead? Is he really dead? Is he really dead? The old man. You say, preacher, what is the old man? What really is the old man? I'm going to read you a commentary from Brother Lauren Marshall. Another thing I want, before I go any further, Sister Marion and Sherry, we've given these out before, but I'd like you to order 30 more of these. These are Brother Lauren Marshall's. It's entitled, Put Off the Old Man. And he quotes from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 and 24, that ye put off, concerning the former conversation, in other words, lifestyle, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Now here's his notes. Listen carefully, please. The Apostle Paul told believers to put off the old man and to put on the new man. Paul was not writing to the lost. He was writing to Christians in Ephesus. The task of putting off the old man and putting on the new man is assigned to believers. The term, here it is, church, what is the old man? The term old man represents the individual dominated by the sin nature. The term new man represents the individual being governed by the Holy Spirit and partaking of God's divine nature. So how are we to accomplish this directive? How can we do it? To live free from the old influence, I simply place my faith in Jesus Christ and his finished work. This is not done through a tedious repetition of words or some religious action. The object of my faith should be the natural default direction of my heart. With my faith secured in the right object of Christ and Him crucified, I lay aside the old man like an old garment, and I am dressed each day in the garments of the new man. This allows me to be influenced, helped, aided, comforted, and led by the Spirit of God. Oh, how marvelous it is to leave behind the lifestyle of the old man each day and encounter the joy of the new man by faith. That's what it means, church. The old man is dead. I'm going to read some more scriptures to you. Bear with me. I want this in our spirit. The Apostle Paul would also tell the church at Colossae, recorded in the book of Colossians chapter 3, beginning at the very first verse. If you then be risen with Christ, if, big question, two letters, if you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on earth, for you are dead. You are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. Therefore, mortify therefore your members, which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, covetousness, which is idolatry, for which things sake the wrath of God comes on the children of disobedience, in the which you also walked sometime in the past, when you lived in them. But now, you also put up all these things: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not to one another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him who created him. In other words, church, I remember another thing. I've said it many times. I'm going to say it again. I love this incorrect grammar that Brother Lauren Larson used. If you is what you was, you ain't. If you is what you was, you ain't. In other words, there's been a change. You said it. When you come to the Lord, there's a change. In other words, it's progressive. Number one, there's going to be an immediate change. The focus of your heart is on the things above. And if it's not on the things above, it's on the things below. And what Paul showed Timothy about the last day church, we can become that church. Hear me today. It's by his grace and his grace alone, church, that we tap into daily. Remember what Jesus said: if you're going to be my disciple and come after me, you deny yourself. Take up your cross daily and follow me. Luke 9:23. Daily. This has got to be a daily thing, church, because if you let it go on, Satan is going to find a crack. I'm telling you right now, the Holy Spirit was all over me early this morning. And I'm not talking about spiritual disciplines per se and put you under law. This pastor will never do that. There's too many churches. If you want to go to a church that's going to put you under law, just go pick one. I mean, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They try to connect the dots for you. That's why the church is dead. We want the Holy Spirit to be our guide.
Yes. Amen.
He's the one that leads you into all truth.
Amen.
A preacher can lead you the wrong way. A loved one can give you bad advice. But the Word of God is truth. And the Spirit of truth will always lead you right to Him.
Amen.
Every single time. Again, I'm not talking about your family. You see, sometimes we can blame our family. Lord, this wife you gave me. Woo-wee. Oh, And then we begin to make excuses. Did you do that to her?
No.
Better not. Look at the man in the mirror. Allow the Holy Spirit to examine you this morning. Is your affection on the things below, or is it on Him? You see, that's why. You see, we're going to have trials and tribulations. I don't care. You could say, Pastor, I just got to live at the church. I'm going to put a tent out there. I'd let you. That's what you want to do, but that ain't going to make you holy. You can probably pray 724. Ain't going to make you holy. You can read that word backwards and forwards and build or quote it right, left. And yes, I love quote the word of God. I read it daily. I pray daily. But that don't make me holy. It's His holiness, His righteousness that's imputed to you and I. And when the church begins to truly realize that, deep within the inner man, don't leave here like you came today. Allow the Spirit to touch your heart and examine you. How close are you really to the Lord? What does your relationship really look like with the Lord? Is it, well, again, it's her fault. It's His fault. That sorry boss of mine, he's the one that makes me sin. You see, that's what Adam and Eve did in the Garden of Eden, didn't they? They blamed the serpent. They blamed each other. And by doing that, they were actually blaming God. It was Eve. It was the serpent. Instead of taking accountability, I'm the one that sinned, Lord. I'm the one that has sinned. You see, even though I mentioned that there's more calls for prayer for the family, again, perilous times shall come. You see it. You see it from the word of Almighty God. But I remind you, the very first family were murderers. Cain killed his brother Abel. Did he or did he not? The very first family. Cain slew Abel, his younger son. Now why? Why did that happen? Think about that for a minute. Why did it happen? Well, sin, yes, but why? Why? Oh, there's symptoms. He was jealous. He was angry. Because God accepted Abel's sacrifice and rejected Cain's. So, God loves him more. God loves him more. God approved of him. He approved of God. And even the Lord said, if you go do thus and so, your sacrifice will be accepted. Don't forget what we preached on last Sunday. Preached it hard. Passover equals Passover. Passover, okay, allows Passover. You see, the sacrifice of Abel was per the will of God. It was a type and shadow of Jesus Christ our Lord going to Calvary. It was accepted. But Cain, the fruit of his labor, he worked hard. And yes, you are to work hard. I am to work hard. We are to earn our keep, so to speak. The Bible says if you don't work, you don't eat. I get all that. But you cannot take the fruit of your labor and lay it down before God and say, oh, bless me, God, because I did thus and so. It won't work. It won't work. The Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags. That's what you're offering. That's what Cain was offering to the Lord, is his filthy rags. Yes, you will be blessed, but you can't bring it to him saying, Lord, cleanse my sin because I gave $100. That won't work. Oh, cleanse my sin because I summed my heart up. Oh, you you think I go before the Lord saying, Lord, you called me to be a pastor? Bless me? No. I'm blessed because the Father blesses him. My blessings and your blessings flow through Calvary. That's where they come from, church. Get in your heart and in your spirit that the object of your faith is Jesus Christ and what he did for you, and don't move it. Yeah. Don't allow anyone to move your faith, because if you do, let me show you. Back to the original foundation text this morning from John. Number one, Jesus wept. Jesus wept. Sin hurts God. He loves us with a love that you and I cannot comprehend. Just like your children, which you love your children, but you don't love them as much as God does. When you see them mess up, it breaks your heart. Does it or does it not? Amen. You weep over them. But God, the Lord Jesus Christ, is weeping over the specter of death. When he created man to live forever. That was his desire. Even through foreknowledge, he knew that man would fail. But that was still God's desire, that you and I live forever and there would be no death. But when sin entered in, that ushered in death. The law of sin and death. So he would weep. Jesus, therefore, again groaning in himself, comes to the grave. This is our Lord and Savior, God Almighty. He's groaning in himself as he approaches the grave. He's hurt. How far has man fallen, you and I will never know. Maybe when we get to heaven. We'll never know what it was like in the Garden of Eden and how Adam and Eve were really blessed. What their capabilities, mankind being, would have been had we never sinned. But Jesus is groaning over the death of Lazarus, his friend. But it's bigger than that, church. It was hurting him, the death of his creation. Think about, some of you have animals. You've had animals die, I'm sure, if you've had animals for any length of time. Didn't feel good, did it? That's a pinprick. One drop in the ocean of man falling and the pain. But God didn't leave him there, did he? Jesus didn't leave him there. And Jesus doesn't want us to leave here today like we came. Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time he stinks, for he has been dead 4 days. That's what sin is. It stinks. Jesus would say, Lazarus, come forth. Do you remember, Katrina, when the Lord said, Katrina, come forth? Why don't you think about that just a minute? When you were born again. The Bible says we were dead in trespasses and sins. The law of sin. No relationship with God whatsoever. And yet, he said, Peggy, come forth. Come forth. Kevin, come forth. Come forth. Come forth. Come forth, Sherry. Come forth. You were dead in a grave. You were behind a stone, even though you were alive physically. Jesus, the grace of God Almighty, reached out to you. And you said, oh, yes, Lord. And he said, come forth. one of us, starting right here, Paul said, I'm the chief among all sinners, didn't he? That's the Apostle Paul. Who am I to even compare myself to the footsteps and the shadow of the Apostle Paul? But here we go. We have a situation where, well, before I make that statement, let's let Scripture interpret Scripture. Let's do that. Now I'm going to read to you from the book of Romans, chapter 6, verse 3 through 5. Know you not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Verse 6, knowing this, that our old man, here we go again, old man, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he who is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Glory to God, that's a mouthful. In other words, less of me and more of him, that he becomes his divine nature, is consuming and expelling the sin nature out of me and you. That there's less things that when our tongue wants to shoot off, the Holy Spirit says, And before you know it, you're not even thinking them thoughts no more, because you're setting your affections on the things above, not on the things below. There is righteous indignation. Yes, there is, when you've been done wrong. Yes, there is, but that is few and far between. Most of the time, if you start digging into it, you've got to look at yourself. Allow the Holy Spirit to examine you. Are you still dealing with the old man and not on the new man? Are you trying to go back to that carnal nature instead of relying on the divine nature? You see, what do I mean by Lazarus coming forth and so do you and I? All right. So we were dead. The Lord saved us. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 through 5. I just read it to you. Baptized into his death. Now we come out. The Bible says to walk in the newness of life. Walk in the newness of life. Lazarus didn't do that though. Not away, did he? He came out, he was resurrected, raised from the dead, but he was still bound by grave clothes. That's what's wrong with the church today. There's too much of the old clothes still on the new man. There's too many that's having the old man's clothes on the new man, and it stinks. That's what Martha, his sister, said. He's been in the tomb for 4 days. Lord, he stinks. Here he is, risen. Bible says, face covered, bound, hands, feet. We sing that the chains are gone. Chains are they gone in your life? Or is there still the old man? What clothes do you have on? Is it the old man still clinging, the clinging vines of the old man? Is there still bandages trying to hold you back that stinks? You're honest with yourself. you'll see that this pastor is telling the truth. For all have sinned and fell short of the glory of God. Mm-hmm. Not just me, not just you, not just you. All have sinned and fell short of the glory of God. It must be a daily, daily faith, church. It can't be just on Sundays and Wednesdays or Tuesdays. It's got to be daily. And you can't blame family. You can't blame your neighbor. It's made you mad. You can't blame it, blah, blah, blah. I'm not saying people don't do you wrong. Oh, yes, they will. Especially in the day and hour which we live of spiritual warfare, you can read this in Ephesians chapter 6 about spiritual warfare. But notice what Paul said. In Ephesians chapter 6, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. So if we're wanting to blame the preacher, if you're wanting to blame the spouse, if you're wanting to blame the kids, if you're wanting to blame the employer, if you're blah, 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 he goes on to say, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but spiritual wickedness in high places. Principalities, darkness in high places, church. That is where the fight of good faith comes in. That's what I remember last week when I told you. The Bible says the fight is not yours, the battle is the Lord's. There is where you get tested. Where am I going to put my faith? Where am I going to anchor it? Am I going to pound and I'm going to get my pound of flesh? Am I going to strike back? Or I'm going to say, oh Lord, I'm your child. I give it to you. I surrender it to you, Lord. I'm still a work in progress. I'm not righteous. The Bible says none are righteous. Only you are righteous, oh Lord. I'm bringing it to you. You're the righteous one. You're the holy one. When we sing, are we singing about ourselves up here? We are. It's saying we're sinners or something. And that we're changed by the power of God Almighty. But we're singing unto Him, the Lord and Savior of our life. But it's got to be daily, church. Let me tell you about some Christians. And I used to fall in this category. I'm going to say it full disclosure again. I'm a work in progress. Spiritual roller coaster. Spiritual roller coaster. They come to church. They get their spiritual high. Woo! Shouting, praising God. Bless me, amen. The Holy Spirit begins to move on your heart. The word or the seed of the word goes in your heart, Skylar. It's planted in there. But what do you do with it then on Monday? What do you do with it? Do you go right back to the Lord and allow the Spirit, the washing of the word, the Holy Spirit to begin to wash that seed and begin to take root and begin to grow in you? Or is it the old man on Monday? Is it the bandit? Bandages still wrapped. Don't leave here today, I beg you. The bandage is on. And you can't do it in your strength. You hear me? Because whatever, I'm going to tell you again, every one of us has weaknesses. Don't we? Every one of us has weaknesses. Every single one of us. Because we born in original sin. And the devil knows a proclivity in each one. In other words, a bent towards. In other words, if he can't trip you up on one thing, he'll try to trip you up on something else.
Amen.
If you jump over one stumbling block, say, oh, God bless me. He'll say, uh-huh. Okay, now pride's kicking in. Uh-huh. Katrina just jumped it. She jumped over that stumbling block. Look at me. Well, you know what? Pride will kill you. See, Satan knows us. He knows mankind. He fell from pride, and he'll do everything he can to appeal to your pride that you're right and I'm wrong. When you're in a conversation, I'm right, you're wrong. Every time he will do that. But it takes the humbling and the control of the Spirit of the living God to say, I want you to look at you. Let me look at you. Let me, being him, look at you and see if the two agree. You see, he's going to dig deeper than we want to. That's why I said this morning, right in Hebrews, said the word is quick. It's alive. You see, when you read the word of God, it's not like a novel. It's not like American history. It's not a magazine. It's alive. And it is sharper than any two-edged sword. Therefore, it'll build you up and edify you. But if there's something in you that needs to be cut out, like when you go for an operation and the doctor says, I got to cut that out of you, are you going to die? Are you going to get sicker? What do you want the doctor to do? Leave it in. Now you ain't cutting on me. Leave it in. You just went through several surgeries, hon. Did you want them to cut? Cut, cut, cut. We may have more surgeries. You may have surgeries coming. But let me tell you, spiritually, you better desire the love and grace of God to pour over your life and have the Holy Spirit that loves you enough to continue to cut, to continue to conform you into the image of the Lord, to continue that process of sanctification, to get our relationship closer to the will of the Father. If not, let me say this way as I close. I've used this illustration before, but I'm going to use it. I'm walking towards the kitchen. I can't walk two paths at once. Can't do it. Now I'm walking back to the front of the church. Bye, kitchen. See ya. Now let's assume that's where the nourishment's at, a kitchen. Let's assume that's where I'm getting spiritually fed every day by the Spirit of the living God. Either I'm anchored, and when he walks with me, or I walk away. When you walk, meaning your lifestyle, your code of conduct, you're either walking with the Lord, or you're trying to pull away from him. You see, and the Holy Spirit's trying to reel you back in and say, oh, son, oh, daughter, your faith is getting a little bit off track. You see, Satan's going to do what he does. He's going to continue to tempt. There's going to be trials. The church, that's how he tries to drive a wedge between you, your family, between you and whatever relationship it is. Before you know it, that bitterness can creep in and the hardness of the heart begins to happen. And then 2 Timothy chapter 4 begins to play out in our heart and in our life. This is a very hard message. This is one of those messages, if you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. You see, because it's hitting every one of us. It better be hitting every one of you. Amen. If it's not, you better get down on your knees before you leave here and ask the Lord to save your soul. Because it hit me. It hit me hard. It's like last week, this boy right here. The Holy Spirit was all over you last week, son. He was all over you. The Holy Spirit is reaching out. He was all over. Saying grooms don't make mistakes. I can't believe I didn't get a shot and amen from over here. But he doesn't. He doesn't make a mistake, church. And we are the bride of Christ. Don't pull away. Run to him. Useless. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk. Do you believe that today, church? Or is that just something we sing and wave our arms, tap our feet a little bit? Woo-hoo! Or do you believe it? I can't even walk without you holding my hand. If that's in your heart and you know I cannot take a step, because if I do take a step and he's here, I'm going to be stupid and I'm going to walk away. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. He's my object of faith. Jesus Christ and what he did at Calvary for me to set me free to where the sin nature no longer rules and reigns no matter what comes upon my way. That my faith is anchored in him. Lord, you take care of it. You said the battle is yours. I'm surrendering it to the cross today. Tomorrow I'm going to surrender it to you again. When Satan comes in like a flood, he'll raise a standard against him. Lord, you said. Lord, you said. Jesus is my Lord. He is my Savior. He is my Redeemer. He's the first from the last. He's beginning and the end. He's the rose of Sharon. Glory to God. He is the lily of the valley. He is Jehovah Jireh. Lord, I will provide. He is to be our all in all. Praise to you. Please come. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah. And I also messed the praise team up because I, in my spirit this morning, was a special song and they're going to sing it in a minute. And I feel it's either a prayer or a praise, depending upon your relationship with the Lord this morning. Allow the Holy Spirit, as they begin to sing this song, the Holy Spirit was moving on me. And I told Sherry, we've got to get it. It's the very last song. We're only going to sing one song. We may sing it three times, but we're going to sing one song. This song, I'm going to say it one more time, and I'm going to turn it over to the praise team. It's either a praise to you, or it's a prayer. Either way, meaning this, either he's touched you today, desires to touch you. Don't leave here. I'm begging you. Those of you at home, don't shut this service off without this song. This song being your praise report today. Let's go to the Lord. Sing it, brother.
Shackled by a heavy burden.
Yes. And the power.
you have the new man on now. Do you have the new man on? Ask the Lord. By faith, I know I've been crucified with Christ at Calvary. And now I'm baptized into his death. And now I'm walking in the newness of life. Glory to God. He touched me. Now I'm whole. Sing it, brothers and sisters. Are you whole?
He touched me.